Hello, everyone.
Love Talk Radio.
All right. Hello, everyone. This is Chrism, and I'd like to welcome you to another conversation about your Kundalini awakening experience. In this conversation, we'll be discussing some of the symptoms that are commonly felt before the Kundalini comes, like in the preparation for the Kundalini, but also after it comes, as in the activation or awakening of the Kundalini. Let's go right into it, shall we? Obsessive compulsive disorder is given some different. There's some different meanings to it. The Mayo Clinic staff, what they're saying is, OCD obsessions are repeated, persistent, and unwanted ideas, thoughts, images, or impulses that you have involuntarily and that seem to make no sense. The obsessions typically include when you're trying to think or do other things. Obsessions often have themes to them, such as fear of contamination or dirt, having things orderly and symmetrical, aggressive or horrific impulses, sexual images or thoughts. And then the obsession symptoms and signs may include fear of being contaminated by shaking hands with another person or touching objects others have touched, like an elevator button or, you know, door handle. Doubts that you've locked the door or turned off the stove. Thoughts that you've hurt someone in a traffic accident. Intense stress when objects aren't orderly or facing the right way. Images of hurting your child, impulses to shout obscenities in inappropriate situations, avoidance of situations that can trigger obsessions, such as shaking hands, replaying pornographic images in your mind, dermatitis because of the frequent hand washing, and skin lesions because of the picking at your skin, and hair loss or bald spots because of hair pulling. Doesn't sound like a lot of fun, does it? With the obsessions, the compulsions typically have themes such as washing and cleaning, counting, checking, demanding reassurances, performance of the same action repeatedly, and orderliness. Certainly I don't have the orderliness problem. The compulsion symptoms and signs may include hand washing until your skin becomes raw, checking doors repeatedly to make sure they're locked, checking the stove repeatedly to make sure it's off, counting in certain patterns, arranging your canned goods to face the same way. Now, I can't say that I would agree with that one. I mean, we all might want to read what it is going to prepare. Wikipedia describes it as being a bit different, which I'm finding is a little more appropriate within a Kundalini context. They see it as an anxiety disorder characterized by intrusive thoughts that produce uneasiness, apprehension, fear, or worry by repetitive behaviors aimed at reducing the associated anxiety, or by a combination of such obsessions and compulsions. And they go into the washing and cleaning, but they add extreme hoarding, preoccupation with sexual, violent, or religious thoughts, relationship-related obsessions, aversion to particular numbers and nervous rituals such as opening and closing a door a certain number of times before entering and leaving a room, and so on and so forth. So with those two somewhat similar views, the Kundalini awakening person, even before they have an overt awakening, such as a spinal sweep, which is the pressure at the base of the spine and a release of tremendous forces of energy shooting up the spine, out the top of the head, it can feel like a freight train going up the spine, and it shakes you, and it's quite dramatic, life-changing, life-altering experience. In the build-up to that experience, even from childhood, people can have some of these traits. And I'm this is not a normal program for what I usually speak of with regards to the Kundalini awakening in a person, but I do feel that it needs to be said simply because some of these OCD signs and symptoms can very easily be Kundalini symptoms, but misconstrued. So, for instance, some of you may have experienced the phenomena with your Kundalini where you see geometric objects, very fine displays of geometric objects in specific formations, triangles, lots of triangles, and the different sacred geometrical formations that we often see in the crop circle phenomena. One can experience this with the Kundalini in a prelude to having the overt signs and symptoms of the awakened Kundalini. So one can see these geometrical images, and these images actually, you know, we're connected to them. You know, as we're connected to all things, we're also connected to these geometrical images and shapes, and I'll go so far as to say consciousness. Consciousness can be geometrical in an energetic context. So this level of geometrical consciousness, our consciousness can reach into. And so, you know, when you're sitting at the table and you just, you know, maybe it's a special occasion and you're making sure the forks and the knives and the spoons are just exactly straight. The plate is just exactly a certain distance from the edge of the table. The glass is placed between the specific utensils in a certain perfect way, perfect order. Well, the Kundalini person that's coming into the Kundalini later in their life, this may happen to them all the time. You know, I know for me, that, you know, I could stand it. I could see a picture on the wall that was crooked, even by a millimeter. I could feel that picture being so crooked, but I wouldn't necessarily go up and correct it. But I could notice it. I could feel it. I could see it. And the same with certain things that are not in an expected form of alignment, like being perfectly in a line and things of that nature. But this didn't reach the proportions where a large part of my day was taken up making sure that it was absolutely straight on the wall. I just, you know, I was able to just redirect my attention. And I think the amygdala has a lot to do with the person able to just put that away. You just put that away, your amygdala clicks in, and you just don't worry about it anymore. It's just not something that you continue to worry about. People with severe OCD may not have as strong a function, you know, in that part of their brain with the amygdala than a person who, you know, who is preparing to enter into the Kundalini. With some of the other symptoms, such as the violent images, well, these can come. These can come, and these will come later on in the Kundalini environment. These can be overlays or memories from other lifetimes. And I must say right at the beginning that in my experience, reincarnation is a fact. It is not a possibility. It is a fact, and it is part of how we evolve as spirits in bodies. We don't do it all in one body. We do it in many different bodies and in many different ways, and you know, many different cultures, different genders, different positions within those many different cultures. So these residue experiences can come up, and some of them will be quite violent. some of them will be violent, and as they are violent, a portion of your ego may want to hang on to that as a vector of worry or fear, like, oh, don't let this happen to you type of a scenario. So this does not mean that you have the OCD. Constantly checking on something that's important to you. If it's a call from a girlfriend or a call from a boyfriend, you know, especially if it's a new relationship and you're not quite sure where you stand within that relationship. Well, the first thing I will say is you stand with yourself. You stand perfect. You are that beautiful, wonderful person that other person is interested in, or you wouldn't be having this type of a communication. So don't worry about that. Don't worry about that. But you can check and check and check if they, you know, if they owe you a text or if they owe you a call. But I will also suggest that this can happen within the Kundalini awakening environment, either pre-awakening or after awakening has occurred. And this, once again, does not mean that you have OCD. What I'm saying is that many of the OCD symptoms and the Kundalini symptoms will be very similar. And these similarities can become confusing. And so if you go to an MD and you say, oh, well, you know, I like to line up my silverware on the dinner table, and geez, you know, I really like to know what kind of soup I'm having that day, so I might want to turn the labels all one direction so that I can read it. So you can see I've had a little issue with that one. Sexual images, when the Kundalini is infusing the second chakra during its transformational ascent up the spine, and I do separate the spinal sweep from the transformational ascent. The spinal sweep is, you know, that is the initial ascent of the Kundalini up the spine, out the top of the head. The transformational ascent is when all the changes to the physical, emotional, mental, psychological, and spiritual bodies are being made. And that's often much slower. And it doesn't necessarily go from bottom to top. Sometimes it will go top down. Sometimes it'll go in different combinations. I espouse a bottom-to-top practice so that you can go from density into less density, and that seems to make it a little bit easier. Not saying that any of it is the easiest thing that a person will ever do, but it's much more difficult to go from a less dense aspect of behaviors into a more dense aspect of behavior. So this is what I have found throughout my years of work with people having Kundalini. So with the infusion of the second chakra, the sexual thoughts will come much stronger than you normally would have them come. But once again, this is not any reason to slap yourself with an OCD diagnosis. Okay. This is part of the Kundalini coming up and rewiring the Dan Chen, or the second chakra, and the first chakra as well. Both of those chakras share different responsibilities within the sexual response. So with that in mind, if you have severe sexual urges and you're repeating pornographic images in your mind, and pornography is not something that I support within a Kundalini context, but I know in the United States, at least, we're surrounded with soft pornographic images that the mind and the ego is all too happy to take into further experiences of lust and sexual expression. So, you know what you'll be tempted with in print or in film, but is not completed there. Your ego and the mind will definitely complete it for you. But once again, this does not mean that you are OCD. This means that you are having Kundalini, and the Kundalini itself is broadening the spectrum of what your sexual response would normally be. So these are things for you to understand. These are things for you to understand about the fine, somewhat very fine differences between obsessive compulsive disorder and a Kundalini activation or awakening, or the preliminaries leading up to that. For those of you who would like to call in, we have a guest call-in number, and that is area code 347-934-0026. That's 347-934-0026. And you can call anytime, and I believe that Centaur will be handling that, so you'll get to speak with her at first. So continuing with the OCD. Sometimes after the Kundalini has come and it's in the first aspects of its awakening within you, as I've mentioned in other conversations, you will be contacted by discarnate consciousness. And some of the discarnate consciousness that you're first in contact with will be of a challenged moral or ethical expression. And some of these expressions will counsel you to shout out an obscenity where it's inappropriate to do so, counsel you to commit acts of violence upon other people, counsel you to go into deep pornographic repetitions and areas of say bondage, or severe areas of what in the West we would see as depraved sexual expressions. And I want you to understand that, you know, this, just because you have a discarnate entity giving you a compulsion to do that, you can choose not to do that. You do not have to do these things. Now, sometimes, quite often, the first and second chakra will be tied in with these urges to do these depraved things. So sometimes the communication is received by the person and the visuals are given, but also a compulsion, and this is part of the OCD compulsion matrix, the compulsion will be given to enact some of these sexual expressions, and the person will go out and do that. And if you have done that, I don't want you to think that you were mentally ill or you know, you're any less perfect, beautiful, wonderful person than anybody who hasn't done these things. We are not trained in the West to understand the intricacies of a Kundalini awakening event, and certainly not the differences between OCD and Kundalini awakening symptoms. So you wouldn't necessarily know to be able to discern between a discarnate entity saying, oh, you know, go do this or that sexually, and you know, you may feel a compulsion to do it, and because it's connected to the sexual gratification centers, then of course, you know, you will go out and do that, and now you may think twice about doing that, but I don't want you to judge yourself harshly. Some of these expressions go far beyond what is socially acceptable in our society. Definitely do not do anything that hurts other people or commits damage upon yourself, permanent damage. I know that some of the expressions may apply limited, painful type of scenarios, but, you know, which of course, you know, a person can heal from. But, you know, some of the more damaging areas you just don't need to go into at all. And you don't need to keep yourself locked into this compulsion. Sometimes that happens with people. They get locked into an OCD-like sexual trap, and they spend a long time there. And I just want you to understand that you do not have to spend time there. You do not need to do that. This is not something that you cannot control. Once again, your amygdala can click in, and you can just change that channel. You can change that channel. The sexual areas are one area where we can really get stuck, because it's got that whole pleasure, pain center within it. And in our society, clearly 80% of our society has some sort of a sexual message in it, you know, whether it's the advertising or it's movies or it's television or it's print or, you know, anything on the internet, things of that nature. So constantly we're being deluged with sexual imagery and expectations of how a man or a woman or a young man or a young woman are supposed to live up to the sexual expectations of their peers. The entities have a role in this. The discarnate consciousness will have a role in this. And if you're a pre-Kundalini person, or even after, especially actually after the Kundalini has come up, you want to be very discerning about what information that comes to you, you pay attention to. In many cases, there is a telepathy skill that is being given to you by the Kundalini. And so you may be able to tap into sources of information that you don't realize you're tapping into. It's not necessarily a switch that you throw inside your brain and go, okay, now Chrism's telepathic. It doesn't necessarily work that way. Sometimes it just turns itself on, and, you know, you're all of a sudden you're deluged with all these different levels of information, thoughts that you know aren't yours, but you're thinking of them, and because you're not thinking in the context of telepathy, well, then, of course, they must be yours, too, but they're not, because it's telepathy, but you don't know you're having telepathy. So you think they're yours. And, we have many different people in our society that are working through many different levels of karma and spiritual evolution, and as you walk through that mall or, you know, through that stadium or the grocery store or wherever you are, and you happen to stand up or, you know, stand next to a person that maybe got some real sexual issues that they're working on, this may bleed over into you, into your consciousness, and I want you to really understand that if it isn't like you typically, then it isn't you. And then once again, you can use the amygdala to just change the channel. The amygdala is very, very, very important in a Kundalini context, because it allows you it's like a control switch for the higher consciousness. The higher consciousness of the human being, not the ego body so much, but the higher conscious person who is diligent and honest truthful and has the quality of being able to control some of the more challenging tendencies that the ego will want to go with. So with regards to the sexual traps, with Kundalini, that will come and it will go. It will typically last maybe at the most 6 months from the onset of a first and second chakra transformational ascent. Remember, that is the slower ascent of the Kundalini. So know this, understand this. It is normal. You're not sick. You're not depraved. You're not anything but really a person that is coming into extreme levels of enlightenment that our society doesn't prepare us for. And just so everybody knows, this is how I spell enlightenment. It is I-N space L-I-G-H-T space I-N space M-E-A-N-T. Enlightenment. And you are all meant to have this. It is all, Kundalini is in everybody. and including everybody listening to this program. And so understand that enlightenment is what this is all about. And sometimes as our soul, the spectrum of the human soul expressing in a physical body, as those are broadened by the Kundalini, some things will have to be brought to the surface to be released. And sometimes those sexual depraved activities will be brought to the surface, not to be recognized as a way of continuing to do, but as a way of being recognized for release. Okay, I moved beyond this now. You know, I don't need to have a rape fantasy, or I don't need to have any of the challenging sexual fantasies that people will have. And so this once again does tie into the OCD, because the OCD images can come hot and heavy and almost always pornographic. And in many ways, the sadistic type of things. And also the pseudo obscenity, such as in Tourette's syndrome, as in an appropriate time saying an obscenity. This isn't necessarily from you. Okay, this is not necessarily from you. And I must say that there are more entities without bodies than there are people with bodies. And these entities without bodies that are in the many different layers of the lower astral, once it is known that you have a facility to be able to hear or express an intention that is being given from that entity, well then, you know, some people can become platforms for those entities to infest and speak through them in the most impolite and the most inopportune ways at times. And so our science and our society does not understand this yet. Hopefully they will soon. But, you know, maybe karmically somebody needs to go through that experience. Maybe they were once one of those discarnate entities. There are many, many, many different reasons why a person has certain levels of OCD-type expression with the Kundalini. Some of them are karmic. If you have the hand-washing, for instance, that can be a karmic holdover of somebody who has done something absolutely horrible to others, and or conversely had something horrible done to themselves, and one will constantly try to wash off those sins, wash off those actions that a part of their body still remembers, and it becomes, you know, an absolute necessity. Evidently Howard Hughes had some of the hand-washing issues, and, you know, he would wash his hands absolutely raw, bleeding. And so this is also something that you may want to consider, and this is also something that the amygdala usage can take care of. And some of you may be asking, well, geez, Chris, how do I use this amygdala? What the heck is it? And how do I use it? And, you know, what do I do? The amygdala is an organ in the brain, the midbrain. And it is the organ that allows you to put things on the back burner. So let's see. Let me think of an example. Okay, well, you got that traffic ticket. Now you've got this fine. Let's call it a parking ticket. It's like, oh, geez, I got the parking ticket. Now I got to go pay. Well, instead of, maybe you don't have the money to pay that parking ticket at that time. And so you put it on the back of your mind, okay, I got to go pay that parking ticket, and I have to do it within 10 days. Because you don't have the money yet, you can't pay it, and so it's constantly there to worry you. But your amygdala kicks in and goes, no. You can go about your day. Go about the rest of your day. Sure, you got the parking ticket. Sure, you're going to pay it. Sure, you don't have the money right now, but you will have the money and you will pay it, so don't worry about it now. That's the role that the amygdala plays. And it's a very, very important role. Many of these symptoms that come to the Kundalini person that resembles the OCD pattern can be helped by a conscious use of the amygdala. And this happens quite a bit, actually. So let's say you're alone in a house. It's a spooky house. It probably has, you know, ghosts or a different kind of discarnate entity in it. And you turn your head and you see that woman on the stairs and you turn to face it and you just go, oh, it's gone. It's gone. And the amygdala will go, you know, it'll be raising its hand and go, hey, wait, hey, you know, that just didn't happen. That didn't happen. Nope. No, yep, you saw that, but it didn't happen. That's what the amygdala will also do. When you encounter something that goes so far against your expected reality, well, the amygdala can click in and go, well, that just didn't happen. So, yeah, so the amygdala will also do that. But if it happens repeatedly, well, then the amygdala will kind of give in and go, okay, well, maybe that is happening. You know, there we have an entity on that staircase. Wish her well. You know, don't pay any attention. So the amygdala and the OCD and the Kundalini are all tied together. Nice triangle there. With OCD, there are levels, you know, with a strong expression of OCD, it can be more difficult because the compulsion is much stronger. With the Kundalini, some of the compulsions can be stronger, but they will wear off. They are not permanent. They come and they go, just like the kriyas. You know, the kriyas, the spontaneous movements that the Kundalini brings will come and they will go. And then they might show up every now and again, you know, afterwards. But typically you have a space of time where you have the kriyas and then they diminish. Same with the entities. You have a space of time where you experience the entities and then you don't experience them so much. Unless you really want to. And then, of course, you still have the ability to see into the astral. And so with the obsessive compulsion, it's less of an option for control, perhaps because of an amygdala that isn't kicking in as strongly as it normally would. If you have any questions about this, if this is something that you have or you have concerns with, I'm going to give you the number again. It's area code 347-934-0026. 347-934-0026. And please feel free to call in. I know that this is a different time zone for people, and so I know that I don't know if everybody got the information about the time change, but so we are now at 7 o'clock and we'll be giving this a try. But for those of you that connect in the archives, well then, you know, it's whatever time that you want it to be. Okay. So, you know, I think that's fair enough. Now, moving onward, these areas of OCD activity will typically begin at the start or the prelude to Kundalini awakening activity. So, you may walk into a public restroom and you'll see the crisscross lines on the floor, and all of a sudden you'll start seeing shapes and designs moving about your feet, actually moving, and it looks like lines of energies are connecting and things like that. It's kind of nice. It's kind of interesting. It's not harmful, but it's just it's the beginning of a larger story, and it's a really good story, by the way. I must say I can talk about, you know, the issues that people have with Kundalini, but Kundalini is a wonderful experience. It is the most beautiful, loving, astonishing experience a person can have, and more so when they have information about it, less so when you're struggling to find out what the heck is going on. But once you do know what is going on and you really embrace the Kundalini, it is an amazingly beautiful experience, something that everybody should get and hopefully will. That being said, as we begin the Kundalini awakening process, certain areas of OCD may express. But once again, as I've mentioned before in other conversations, you may want to keep some of these things to yourself. You don't necessarily need to tell your doctor everything, especially with regards to Kundalini. They don't recognize Kundalini, therefore they don't really know about Kundalini, therefore they're just going to be guessing in any kind of a diagnosis that they try to give you, and usually it's going to, you know, it's going to require, you know, the heaviest tranquilizers like Depakote or lithium or some other kind of tranquilizer that can physically addict you to that tranquilizer, and you'll have to, if you ever want to stop it, you'll have to be titrated down from that with an MD's assistance. You know, and I'm no MD, and so I'm not expressing any kind of a knowledge of MDs, even though I've worked with them. But you can look it up yourself. I mean, they don't even believe Kundalini exists. And so, you know, where are they going to look in their reference books for information about Kundalini? They believe OCD exists, and so they have reference material for that. They believe bipolarism exists, so they have reference material for that. Schizophrenia, well, they have reference material for that. And since some of the Kundalini symptoms resemble all three of these disorders, therefore they make their decisions based upon those reference points rather than the truth of the situation, which is the Kundalini, which is the evolutionary energy in man, as Gopi Krishna put it, which is also the name of his book. So you may want to keep it to yourself. You also may want to keep it away from your parents because they love you and they don't understand Kundalini, and so it scares them, and so they think you're going nuts, and so the next place you'll find yourself is in a psych ward with your parents looking at you through the window with extremely worried expressions. Whatever happened to Chrism? Oh my gosh, he just went nuts. Yeah, talking about ghosts. Energy up the back. Oh my God, where did we go wrong? What happened? Anyway, so yeah, be very, very careful about who you tell your symptoms of Kundalini to. Most people will not understand. Do your best to get your information privately and quietly. And you can go to my YouTube page, which is Chrism and then the number 0, which is like a big O, Kundalini. So like Chrism O Kundalini on YouTube. And I have about 223 videos out now. And those can be of some assistance to a person who's coming into this in a new way. None of this is to be afraid of. OCD is not to be afraid of. It is something that you can get through. With Kundalini never goes away. Kundalini is there for your life. And I'm sorry that if you're having a difficult time with it, you're only having a difficult time with it because you're refusing to surrender to it. And really, the only thing that you surrender when you surrender to the Kundalini is is the negative control that ego or the or entities may have over your decision-making process. If you are a loving person, well, you're still a loving person. If you're a truthful person, you're even more truthful. If you're a patient person, you're a patient person. If you know, if you're a kind person, you're a kind person. It doesn't make you different than how you are. What it is you're embracing a new energetic reality within you that affects you in very tactile ways. This isn't airy-fairy, you know, this isn't fairy dust somebody with a wand is sprinkling over your head. This is a real thing. It's a real thing, and it comes with very real, tactile expression upon and through you and around you. So much so that the animals will notice it. You'll notice animals will start staring at you. Wild animals may walk right up to you. This is a hallmark of Kundalini. If you look at St. Francis of Assisi, well, he had Kundalini. You know, many of his pictures that you see him, well, the animals just love him. Well, of course. He's got Kundalini. Of course they're going to love him. You know, it's like insects to a flame, so they will love him. And the same thing will happen with you to various degrees. So look at these minor symptoms, the spasticity that can occur, the distaste with shaking hands. Let's talk about that a little bit. That does not typically happen within a Kundalini context. The shaking hand issue and the washing hand, the overwashing of the hands, that doesn't really coincide so much with the Kundalini matrix. Neither does licking the doorknobs. If you there's a radio program on NPR or the public station in the States called This American Life, and one of the authors there is a gentleman by the name of David Sedaris. He tells a pretty good story. And in one of his stories, he tells about his life growing up with obsessive compulsive disorder, and I recommend you to listen to that story. It's very educating. And if you have Kundalini, then it will really, once again, it will help you discern what is not happening to you. The whole reason for this particular program today is to help you discern what is and what is not of the Kundalini and what is and is not of the obsessive compulsive disorder. With the obsessive compulsive disorder, you don't typically get to have a spinal sweep. You won't have kriyas. You won't have visions of gods or exalted individuals coming down to you in golden light. You won't typically get visited by Christ or Krishna or Mary or any of the deities. That won't necessarily happen. You can have visions of pornographic images given to you. You can have also some of the Tourette's like symptoms given to you, the explosions of inappropriate words being said at a family gathering or something like that. You can have the desire to make things straight, which I don't see as a big problem. That's not a big issue. Turning your labels in your pantry so that one way. Well, that's fine too. I mean, geez Louise, I don't think we have to make everything a disorder. I think we're a little disorder crazy in the West here. Now some of the things, yes, of course, washing your hands till they bleed, that could be seen as somewhat of a disorder that's causing harm to the body. Saying expletives at a family gathering, that can be also seen as a disorder. I mean, but geez, if you go to some folks, expletives are just part of the language. I think the OCD aspect would be to say something nice at the table. I'm sure that doesn't happen to anybody listening here, though. We've been trained in our society to to use expletives every other word. I just went to a movie with another Kundalini person. It was called Last Watch or something about the Last Watch. End of Watch, I think. Anyway, it's about Los Angeles police officers. And, you know, basically just kind of going through their job, you know, what they do at night and all of this. And it seemed kind of like a reality show that was lengthened into a movie. Can't say it was overly enjoyable, but, you know, I think it was fairly truthful in a lot of different ways. And one of those truthful ways was the level of expletives that are used interspersed within the English language. This is quite copious in some areas of society, and so I'm not sure that, you know, maybe if you're living in an extremely conservative environment, you know, very deeply religious environment, and all of a sudden, boom, you come out with an expletive that you probably never said in public before, well, okay, I'll accept that. But, geez, you know, you look at some of the different aspects of our society, and expletives are quite a common theme. Not strange at all. One of the other aspects that the Mayo Clinic gave for OCD is extreme religious devotion. And once again, you know, I'm going to have a little bit of an issue with this. Kundalini will bring extreme devotional prostration and prayer and meditation and recitation of mantras and prayers and a total and complete observation of the absolute reality of the divine upon this world. And of course, the scientists, doctors at the Mayo Clinic are saying, well, that's obsessive compulsive. That's definitely a disorder, you know, because we don't believe in any of that. Therefore, it's a disorder. It is not a disorder. It is an aspect of your enlightenment. It is a recognition of the divine upon the mundane physicality of this world, and of a person who is being changed into a temple of the divine, a walking, talking temple of divinity amongst the masses that don't recognize it. But it still has its force and effect. Extreme devotion is not OCD. So if you have this, do not consider yourself obsessive compulsive about this. You just may... You know, you may want to go into a convent or a temple or a place where you can do that type of thing and not be labeled obsessive-compulsive by the medical community. Okay, you may just want to explore that kind of an option that you have. So I am extremely devotional. I see God and Goddess. I see Christ. I see Kuan Yin. I see divinity everywhere. I'm staring at the wall right now. And I have divinity on the wall, but I see divinity everywhere in everything, in every person, in every spark of life and consciousness. I go outside right now, I look up at the stars, there's divinity there too. Okay, divinity is real, and it can be recognized without controlling aspects of our society trying to diminish it because they don't understand it by calling it a disorder. Okay, so you might have noticed I have a little issue with that. Okay, so the washing of the hands overly, you know, until you're bleeding, well, that's one thing. That I can see as an obsessive compulsive situation. The Tourette's, the Tourette-like exclamations, I can see as being entity-influenced. I've always seen this as an entity. As a matter of fact, in my homeless stage, when I was having a difficult time with Kundalini, well, I was homeless. And And I remember I was sitting in a Taco Bell one time and having lunch. Not the food that I recommend people eat, but that's what I could afford at the time. And an alcoholic was just a few tables away, and the entities were having a great time with him. He was talking with them, and they were talking through him, and all of this type of thing. And I decided to put him into a golden light, a golden field of light. And, oh, my God, did the entities just light up. And they were so angry at it. He'd look at me, and you could tell it wasn't him looking, and he'd say, "Back off, Jack." Just like that. "Back off, Jack." And I could see, you know, I didn't back off. I didn't. I pushed him out. But I knew that because of his karma that he would invite them back in because of he was, you know, with alcohol, you basically burn holes into your energetic envelope. And so, of course, the entities will always be able to come in as long as you're doing that. But it was interesting. It was an interesting little test for me at the time. With the Tourette type of OCD thing, the expletives, the bad words said at the most inopportune and inappropriate times, I would say are probably more entity-based. And so, therefore, as Kundalini comes to you, those entities may just want to try to get a finger into a control matrix for you to shout that obscenity at an inopportune time, and once again, your amygdala will catch it. Your amygdala will go, "No, I'm not going to say that." Okay? So we'll move on into some of these other areas that they state. Having things orderly and symmetrical, as I said, I'm not really buying that. Aggressive or horrific impulses. Once again, I can see these as kind of lessons of what not to do. Sometimes the Kundalini will bring you an aggressive or a horrific image. If you are an aggressive person, if you're a person that gets in fights or that has in some way a level of karma that is left over from another lifetime experience, well, you may have these horrific images coming to you. They'll come from a world war, World War One, or World War Two, or the Vietnam War, if you're, you know, a combatant in that war. Even Roman wars and wars of antiquity. We've all lived many lives. Some of us may have been soldiers in those wars, and we may not have addressed all the karma that's associated with some of those horrific experiences, whether we're a victim or whether we're perpetrating the experience. And so these horrific images can come to us. And if we are addicted to some pharmaceutical drugs or SSRIs, you know, treating ADHD or, you know, or any of the other many varied ways that chemical doctors try to treat mental disease, sometimes these pharmaceuticals can cause these horrific images to become horrific impulses. And once again, you know, the amygdala should help the person not respond to it. Do not bring that into an action. But with some of the things that we've been seeing happening in Sandy Hook, in New Jersey, and in Colorado, and in California, and in many other states, that doesn't always work. Sometimes the pharmaceutical is too strong, and it's made the wrong kinds of changes in the patterns of the brain, and the person goes so far off the deep end that they will kill many, many, many people. And people, you know, will blame it on guns, and it's not guns. It's not guns at all. It's the pharmaceuticals. It's humanity thinking that they can do a better job than the divine. You know, my opinion about that. Once again, we've covered the sexual images. These sexual images, they are part of the Kundalini expression as well. Always try to manipulate them into a positive state, a positive expression. And I don't mean that you just, you know, you have to become, you know, the flying nun or anything. Not that everybody who's listening knows who the flying nun was. You don't have to, you know, I'm not looking at Puritanism here. You know, I just think that something that is maybe nonviolent or you know, not hurting yourself or another person or taking away the freedoms of another person or hurting them, you know, that is the type of sexual expression that I'm looking at here. And so it's okay. It is all right within a Kundalini context to experience these things. Use your judgment. Don't run out into the downtown area, you know. Make sure you're clothed. Don't hang out at the establishments where naked people are selling you drinks or things of that nature. Don't go there. Don't partake in the pornographic industry. Do not partake in the pornographic industry. It is not going to help you. It is going to trap you. And it can trap people for literally the majority of their lives. And so really, really, really look at that carefully. The Kundalini can bring that on. Some of these other things. Counting a certain way, well, not so much a Kundalini thing. The Kundalini, however, will bring series of numbers in levels of, sequences that will boggle the mind, you know. You'll see 11, you know what, you'll see 0123, or you'll see 1111, you know, or 444, you know, all these different number combinations, and they will concern you, and sometimes they will give you consternation, but don't worry about that. Don't worry about that. You're, in many ways, you're being given a message. You're being given a message of solidarity, of the continuation of life, of molecular cohesion. I mean, there are so many different ways that the Kundalini can help you communicate with your world outside of what the conscious ego knows is a real communication. We don't always know how the etheric levels of communication are obtained or generated. And so the ego, because we usually live our day from the auspices of the ego, therefore the ego tries to figure it out, can't figure it out, well, okay, then the problems start because the ego is frustrated. So just let your ego go. Don't try to figure everything out. Understand that what you need to know, you will be allowed to know. You'll be compelled. Here's your OCD, you know, your obsessive compulsion. You'll be compelled maybe to find out more information about it. But it shouldn't become a controlling compulsion. Checking the doors repeatedly to make sure they're locked, I don't have a problem with that unless you do it over 100 times or even 20 times. I mean, it could be a memory issue. Checking the stove. If you've got a gas stove and you want to check that stove repeatedly, I'm all for that. Unless it becomes the only thing you do all day. And of course, there's going to be a problem there. So some of these things, you know, you do, you know, I mean, there's a difference between being a perfectionist and having obsessive compulsive disorder. So, you know, if you keep your house so clean that you could eat off it, or if you like your decorations arranged, you know, in a specific order, that doesn't mean that you have obsessive compulsive disorder. If you're, you know, one of the Kundalini contexts, it certainly doesn't mean that. Orderliness is not a bad thing. Being organized is not a bad thing. It's actually quite a good thing. And the less you're attached to things in your life, the greater your level of detachment will be to the material control vectors that are so prevalent in the West right now. If you have a lot of things, then you know, you have a lot of attachment to the material aspect of Western society, and I will counsel you to do as Eileen has done and some of the other students, where they just get rid of a lot of stuff. They get rid of a lot of things, and as you get rid of these things, you become less controlled by those things. Okay. So I will give the numbers out again just in case someone wants to call. It's 347-934-0026. And Santara is on the phone, and she is waiting for your call. To continue onward about this, I will strongly suggest that you do your best to stay out of fear with the Kundalini. Fear can turn into an obsession as well. When you don't know what's happening or you don't have a clear idea of what's happening to you, fear can become a huge obsession for you. And it can drive you to do things that you would never do. And, of course, if you went to the authorities and said, well, you know, I did this, this, and that because I've been having this, this, and that, and I don't know what it is. And then all of a sudden your life is taken out of your hands. And they begin to decide your future. And so don't do that. If you're not hurting yourself, you're not hurting other people, don't worry about it. If you're having horrific images come to you, that's a different scenario. And if it keeps happening over and over and over again, giving you nightmares, well, then send me an email and we can you know, give you some remedy to that. In many cases, it's just a level of karma. It's also a level of psychic opening that a person with Kundalini is experiencing. And because science doesn't recognize psychic openings, you know, to them it's all just New Age garbage. They can't help you. They can only help you within the areas that they choose to believe are real. 1 + 1 to them is 2. It doesn't equal railroad tracks. Okay. So consider this. Consider this. And if you have any questions, feel free to call us. Looks like I have 22 minutes left in this program. But I think I've said about what I feel like saying. I would like to thank Aaron Santara for getting up at around 3 in the morning, wow, to be with us at her golden hour. This is Santara's golden hour, so what a cool thing. Thank you, Aaron, for coming on like that.
Oh, you're very welcome. You're very welcome.
And if anybody has any questions, you can actually email the Blog Talk channel here. It's Kundalini Awakening Systems, and or you can email at kundalinimatters@gmail.com or myself at kfireforall@yahoo.com. And so, thank you everyone for listening. Thank you those of you who listen in the archives. And look forward to another conversation with all of you. Thank you.